This written record of history on Detroit Radio is reliable and true. Not just because I was there. Also because I was in it. Not just knee deep, but totally deep. What had happened is that Saturday in 1996, around 1 or 2 o'clock in the afternoon, an 11-year-old girl called me on the radio while I was doing my radio show. And she asked me a question. She asked, were there ever any great black classical composers? And she just asked this question totally out of the blue. I did not know how to answer her. I thought to myself instantly, if anyone is precocious enough to ask such a question, it demanded not a frivolous answer, but a very serious answer. So I didn't know what to tell her because I did not know, nor had I been curious enough to find out. So I asked myself, what do I say to her? Do I say yes? And then I said, if she's smart enough to ask such a question, she would certainly ask who. And if I were to say, I don't know, she probably would ask why. So, I decided just to tell her, I don't know, but I will find out, and when I come back on the radio on Monday night, I would announce my findings. After I had been totally transparent with her, I thought at least she would probably say thank you, but instead, she said, would you? So I felt obligated to spend the rest of my weekend trying to find the answer to that question. So I decided to go to Dearborn Music. And when I walked into Dearborn Music, there was a young man behind the counter. His name was Josh Cheeks. I walked in the store and I said hello and I introduced myself. And I was totally transparent. I told him the whole story about the little 11-year-old girl. And she wanted to know, were there ever any great black classical composers? And I came to a classical music store and I figured that if anybody could tell me, they could tell me. And as I was looking into Josh Cheek's eyes, they suddenly started to turn red. And a teardrop fell from his eyes as he was passionately trying to answer the question. And I totally did not know what was going on. But emotionally, he responded to me. He said, you know, it's strange that you would ask me such a question. He said, it's really strange that you would ask a question like that. He said, let me tell you a little story behind it. He said, excuse me for being so emotional about this. He said, you know, I was kind of fighting with my bosses. And I told him that we should do something for Black History Month. and they informed me that we don't have a significant enough of a black clientele to warrant such a project to the scale that you're talking about. And he said, you know what? Maybe we don't have that clientele to that significant degree because we have never really done like a total outreach to that community, and we should. And after talking with them and talking with them, they agreed to let me do my project. So he said, you see that wall over there? He said, on that wall are some of the most incredible black composers that ever existed. He said, I just finished putting the wall up today. And here you come in here and you ask, were there ever any great black classical composers? He said, you got to understand what that is doing to me inside. He said, because, you know, I fought to get this done. And they said, yeah. And no one thought that it would make a difference. And the moment I put it up and I'm looking over there, glancing at it, proud of it, you walk in and ask, were there ever any great black classical composers? He said, well, sure there were. He said, some of the greatest composers. He said, man, he said, you're tearing me up. And I got a little emotional as well. He said, let's go over here and look at this wall. He went over each of the classical composers one by one and talked about each one. I was just blown away when he told me about Chevalier de Saint-Georges and his history and his life story. And all of the stuff that he was telling me, I could not wait to get back to the radio station to talk to this little girl that had asked me that big question and to announce what I had found. I pulled out my checkbook and I purchased everything that he had on the wall. And the wall that they had told him would not make a difference, and he doubted anybody would respond to it. What do you think they felt when they came in the next day to find out that somebody had come in there and bought everything that was on the wall? And I spent the rest of the weekend going through the collection of great black classical composers, which led me to Chevalier de Saint-Georges. I not only found de Saint-Georges, I found William Grant Steele, the Dean of African American Composers. In London, I found Samuel Coleridge Taylor. I found countless great black classical composers that I continued to feature on my show until it was terminated on March 29th, 1996. But it was not terminated without a warning. I was warned that my full-time radio show would come to an end unless all of those great black classical composers that I had suddenly gained such an affinity for would come to an end by March 29th. I was informed by a letter. But one thing that I had big time respect for WGPR, is that, you know, they could have just said, look, cut the composers off or your show is out right now. They gave me a whole month. They trusted me on their radio airways for a month to end all of this classical music. But the response to it had just become so great and so overwhelming, I had to go down with that ship, which ended my full-time stint on Detroit radio.
The legendary Electrifying Mojo, as he's known to his radio audience in Metro Detroit, was spinning the usual discs one day at a Detroit R&B station, just ending an Earth, Wind, and Fire set that when the studio line rang.
I picked it up and this little girl was on the line. She said, "Hey Mojo, tell me, were there ever any great black classical composers ever?" It was such a stunning question, one that I'd never thought about. I didn't know how to answer her, and I didn't want to lie to her and say yes. I didn't want to tell her the truth because I didn't really want her to know that I didn't know. But I decided it was better to tell her that I didn't know, and I would promise to find out for her.
Mojo kept his promise and began one of the most enriching experiences of his life, discovering the wealth of classical music written by black composers. And he decided to write a book about what excited him the most about what he found. When the quest began, he left his job at the radio station rather than stop playing his newfound discoveries on the air. Management told him to stick to the format or leave, and he left. Johnson says he'll keep his book focused on three major composers. The first, French classical composer, Le Chevalier de Saint-Georges, author of the first symphony written by a black composer, and the groundbreaking concerto for violin that was written in 1775.
I think it's one of the great unexplored masterpieces because what he did for classical music in Paris with the Parisian musicians and the French school of music, it became like the paradigm that was duplicated. I mean, people came along and say, like, why reinvent the wheel? It's already rolling. And de Saint-Georges was a guiding force.
De Saint-Georges was born on the Caribbean island of Guadeloupe of an African mother and a French father. They encouraged his talent at a young age and eventually brought him to Paris in the mid-18th century, where he was considered among the premier composers of his day. He accepted with grace the withdrawal of an offer that he be appointed co-director of the Paris Opera, following objections registered with the Queen, fearing that it would be degrading to follow the orders of a mulatto. Historians say he had the most impact on the few other black classical composers at the time, most in Europe and in Brazil. Just before the turn of this century, another black composer gained worldwide attention with a composition that critics at the time say rivaled Handel's Messiah. It was Hiawatha by composer Samuel Coleridge Taylor. Taylor lived in London in the late 19th century, but his effect here in the United States, along with the Civil War emancipation of blacks, helped inspire a new generation of 20th century black composers here in the U.S. This new music formed part of the foundation for black music culture today by drawing from rituals in African culture, signifying, offbeat melodic accents, call and response, and the ring shout. Taylor's groundbreaking work had a major impact on that development.
But the one that had the biggest impact was William Grant Still.
Samuel Floyd is the director of the Center for Black Music Research at Columbia College in Chicago. He says the Afro-American Symphony by William Grant Still is a benchmark in classical music history because it draws on African music traditions in a modern sense.
The Afro-American Symphony, which was performed first in 1931, was the first major symphony to be performed by a black American. And we can see in that work very clearly where the values of the ring shout begin to come into concert hall music by black composers.
Much of the information regarding black classical composers is kind of like written between the lines, and you have to go you have to find so many lines in so many books and merge them together to come up with what really happened.
As Johnson's search continues, he says he's not sure when or if he'll ever revive his legendary Detroit radio status. Finding the richness in black classical music, he says, may have changed his life forever.
Thank you. Thank you. You're listening to Electrifying Mojo Rare Moments. If you like this video, hit the like button. If you wish to subscribe, hit the subscription button. If you like this video, hit the like button. If you wish to subscribe, hit the subscription button. If you wish to subscribe, hit the subscription button. Hit the subscription button.
Do not ever leave home without your mask. Do not ever cook food for you or anyone else without your mask. Do not serve food without your mask.